mind. And,
Father, we thank you for being able to gather this morning to worship you, to praise you, to adore you. For you are good, and your love endures forever. Your mercies never fail, and they're never ending. Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit, your presence, and your power to come and touch our hearts and fill our lives this morning. Lord Jesus, we lift you up. We give praise to you and ask, O God, that you would meet us in this place, that you'd touch our hearts, that we might hear your voice, that we might sense your presence, and that we might feel called to be your hands and feet as the community of Jesus here in Butts County. Lord, this is our prayer, and we worship you, we celebrate, we welcome you today, and the gift and power, the fullness of your Holy Spirit, may it be with us in Jesus' name. Spirit of prayer and praise, will you stand and let's worship the Lord together in song.
Good morning, everyone. It's such an honor to be here to worship with you today. I pray that you have had a wonderful week witnessing to our beautiful community, and that today your presence here just shows that you are ready for the witness and ready for all that God has for you to receive this morning. Open your hearts, open your minds, and sing out to him. This is Come Alive. You don't say KV.
prayer. I just want to encourage you to keep our neighbors, our folks in the community in prayer, especially the Vicki Rapes family, Jerry Rape in particular. Vicki, as many of you know, had a long battle with colon issues. She's been in the hospital for a long, long time. She'd gotten stronger. She was making her way back. And the doctors felt like they needed to get her gallbladder out. And unfortunately, when she went into surgery, she didn't come back out. So Jerry's going to miss her. And we're all going to miss her smile and her humor. I just know about every Sunday morning when I'd say hello, she'd say something like salutations, or I don't know, she'd use some funny word for saying hello, and that was always a joy. And we're going to miss her in the choir and everywhere else. So keep her and her family in your prayers. And then as well, keep Joe Peck in your prayers. Joe and Lynn have had a lot of health issues. Their daughter, Georgia, has had some health issues too. But Joe just recently most likely has some cancer that the doctors are going to need to deal with and treat. And so it has a mass kind of around his kidney area or something like that. So be in prayer for Joe and his healing in the weeks ahead. Any other prayer requests or praises to mention today? All right, since we got a lot of the crowd here, don't forget we've got a barbecue in honor and memory of David Fletcher next week, so see Joni about that. And let's prepare our hearts for prayer. Enjoy. Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, we seek your face and your love and your goodness. Lord, let your glory shine down on us. I pray, Lord, that your voice may reach our ears, that your love may reach our hearts, that your forgiveness may cleanse our lives, that your joy may fill us with courage and strength, that your hope and faith may strengthen us for the days ahead. Lord, as we come to you this morning, help us offer who we are and pray that you can make the most of who we are for your glory. Lord, we invite your spirit and your power and your presence to come and be at work in our midst. Lord, we pray for Vicki Rapes' family, for Jerry, and for just his heart and life and all those in his family, that you'll comfort them in the week ahead. We pray, oh God, for the others we have in prayer, like Joe Peck, who are battling cancer. We pray for his fight ahead, that you'll give wisdom to the doctors, that you'll guide their steps, and that you'll heal him and others going through that similar battle in Jesus' name. Lord, we come against the COVID virus and its work in our community, and just heal those who may have that this week. Lord, we thank you for the chance to worship together. We thank you for the chance to be a part of this community of faith, to love you and to love each other. And Lord, I pray that you'll give us hands, feet, and heart that will care deeply about this community and how you want us to continue to get involved in new ways to make disciples of the Lord Jesus. Lord, open doors to help us connect with new people, make new relationships, develop new communities of faith that might sprout from this home in a way that'll bring you glory, that'll help people surrender their lives to you and know you as Savior and Lord. And in that, you'll bring wholeness and health and strength and opportunity to all of Butts County, oh God. And Father, I pray for just our nation today. Lord, we continue to need to see you at work, doing miracles, touching hearts, transforming lives. As our world and our neighborhoods are filled with way too much violence, way too much anger, way too much hostility, way too many deaths by violence. And Lord, we just pray your spirit might change hearts in a way that'll heal our land. Lord, will you say that if we would come to you in repentance, that you will heal our land, that you will give us blessings and life and hope. And we need that today because, Lord, we know that we have chosen all sorts of paths wander away from you. Lord, bring us back. Help us make you the very center of our lives for your glory. In Jesus' name. And God, we just pray your anointing would be on our president and on all our leaders, whether at the national level or the state level or the community level. Lord, we pray, oh God, that you bless our service members, like our police and firefighters, paramedics, and military men and women. You'd surround their families with love. You'd strengthen them for their call. And you'd help them do their best to keep our community safe and watch over all our neighborhoods. And oh God, we pray for our world today, a world that is hurting, a world that is struggling through pandemic and through isolation and through being shut down. And Lord, people are struggling more with poverty in this day and age than they have in a long, long time. And they need the hope of Jesus. They need the light of Christ. They need the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And so, Lord, we pray that you'll be at work among us for your glory, bringing us to your kingdom throne. Lord Jesus, we cry out to you today. Be at work. Keep being at work. Don't give up on us. We have not given up on you. So in the name of Jesus, we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, guys, it's good to be together with you again this week. And over the next few weeks, I want to do a sermon series with y'all. Basically about looking toward what's next. I hope in these last several weeks I can kind of do a few things with you guys that will get you dreaming, get you thinking, get you listening for the voice of the Holy Spirit, and try to encourage you so that when Andy comes in after me, that you'll be ready to kind of give him some ideas and say, Andy, we're ready to go. We're ready to get moving. And we want to be all that God has for us to be here in this community. And a large part of that is being willing to try new things. And so this morning, we want to look at the call of Jesus together and how that is a critical piece in us finding our direction and in terms of us finding our purpose. And so the scripture lesson this morning comes from Mark's Gospel in the first chapter. And Jesus has preached the good news of the kingdom, called people to repent and trust that God is building something new, and he wants us to be a part of it. And as he does that, this is Jesus' next part of the story. Mark chapter 1, verse 16. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. So at once they left their nets and followed him. Now when he had gone a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat. They were preparing their nets. And without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of God for you and me, the people of God. Thanks. You pray with me. Come, Heavenly Father, bless us today. Send your spirit. Be at work in our midst, Lord Jesus. Help us, everybody here, everybody watching, to hear your voice, to know your call, and to allow you to lead us into new adventures for your glory. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. So as we look at the story before us today, we see Jesus in his first initial steps to call a handful of guys. And it doesn't seem like a whole lot. I mean, it was four guys. You know, you think Jesus would start big, you know, that like Billy Graham, he'd have a big crusade and invite thousands of people to follow him and believe in him and all those things. But he didn't. I mean, he did that in some sense, but he called four guys. And one of the first things that I think I noticed this time in reading it that I really hadn't noticed before, which is the key, I think, to what we need to hear is the body of Jesus in the 21st century. And that is when he called these four guys, do you notice? He didn't call them at church. Ever noticed that? I never noticed that until I kind of reread it. He did not call them at church. Now, back then it wouldn't have been church. Back then it would have been synagogue. But that's not where Jesus gave the call to these guys. It says he was out beside the lake. He was out in the community. He was out with the fishermen. And in the community, he saw these four guys and said, you know what? I think these are the guys that God is calling me to invest in. And so he called them by name. Now, y'all, this little observation, I think, is key for church in the 21st century. We have built church for the last 70, 80 years on the principle that if we just do it, people will come, and then we'll be ready to welcome them once they're here. And brothers and sisters, we can't really afford to do that anymore. The culture doesn't work that way anymore. We have to get out into the community. I have to learn how to get out in the community probably better and look for people out and about. Now, of course, James and John and Peter and Andrew, they may have been at synagogue and Jesus may have had conversations with them there. You know, we don't really know that part of the story. But what we do know is when the call came out in the community. And brothers and sisters, if we are to be all we can be, we've got to find ways to build faith, to make disciples, to grow our faith community, not here within these walls, but outside the walls, in the neighborhoods, and at the houses, and in the coffee shop, you know, Lucy Lou's or Bradley's Tavern or somewhere else. We've got to get out. The church needs to leave the building. And that's the first thing I want us to notice today. That's the first thing I want to encourage you in the weeks and months ahead. How can we leave the building more frequently, more often, and do something that will make God smile? Then the second part, the next step I want you to notice is that the heart of this story is the call of Jesus. The heart of the story is the call of Jesus. And there's nothing like the call of Jesus. Here he called four guys by name and said, will you follow me? Will you go with me? Will you let me invest in your life? And these four said yes. These four said yes, and that meant they had to leave their fishing nets behind. That meant that they had to leave their boats behind. That means for James and John, they had to leave their father behind. That meant that they had to leave all they knew and were familiar with behind. And when Jesus calls us, there is always that component in his call. I think last week, we can't stay where we are and go with God. We have to choose. We have to choose to leave our past behind us in order to find new adventures with Jesus. We can't stay where we are. Go with God. But yet, Jesus calls, and in that call, we find life and hope and joy. I want to tell you a little bit about how this is related to me and my call. You know, as a kid growing up, we were sort of the Easter Christmas churchgoers. I mean, we'd go enough where I'd had enough Bible stories to know a little bit about what was going on, but not really. Most of my church attendance was with my grandparents up in Tennessee, but I didn't really know a whole lot about the Bible. I knew the Old Testament. I turned to my mom when I was 12 or 13 and said, "Mom, I know the Old Testament's really old. It's been around a long time. This New Testament, when was it written? 20 years ago? 40 years ago?" Because it was new, right? I mean, that's what new means. But then in my eighth grade year, at the end of my eighth grade year, I heard Jesus' call at a Christian camp that my grandmother had sent all her kids to. And I'd resisted for years, but finally went to their camp, found that the good news that Jesus had died to take away my sin, to forgive me, to give me a new relationship with the one who made me. And so that week, I didn't totally understand all that it meant, but I said yes. And in saying yes, I wasn't sure that anything had really changed. I wasn't sure what it meant to kind of leave my boat and my family and whatever behind, but I said yes. And I didn't notice a whole lot of changes at first, but along the journey, when I got home, the one thing I started to do is I started to read the Bible as a habit for the first time in my life. And y'all, that's one of the best things you can do to respond to God's call and to hear God's call. Because as I began to read John's Gospel, it's like light bulbs began to go off. And I was like, man, this is cool. Man, God's really here. And in that interaction, I started having insights into the Bible a little bit and thinking, you know what? God really is involved in my life and my world. And I started to sense that he was speaking to me through his scripture. It's amazing what happens when we make a habit of prayerful Bible reading. God begins to call us. So out of that call, we began to get involved more than Easter and Christmas. And so I got involved in church. And in church, one of the cute girls at church was a part of a youth choir. And so I joined the youth choir while she dropped out like 2 weeks later. But I stayed in. We started touring and sharing our faith and all those sorts of things. And as I got older in the faith, I started having experiences. The first choir tour we went on, there was this moment where we were kind of arm in arm with new friends that I've made. And I just felt this overwhelming love, this transcendent, deep, amazing love. Love for these new friends that I've made, but also the love of God. And I just said, wow, this really is what it's all about. And then a year or two later, we had a youth guy come in from Asbury Seminary, and he began teaching about being filled with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. And that was another moment where we come to the altar and say, Lord, we want to give you everything. We want your spirit to fill us to the full. We want you to be in charge of our lives. And again, God's call is leading me step by step of the way. And so then I began sharing my faith. I began sharing little testimonies in our choir trips or sharing devotions on our mission trips. Debbie, it's important. I saw Debbie in here somewhere. Debbie, it's important that you give the kids some responsibility. I know, like, you do senior sermon. That's great. But give them responsibility all along the way to exercise their gifts like they did me. Because after one retreat, we were at Panama City for the weekend, and I'd given a little devotion. My youth pastor came up afterward and said, Chris, I don't know, but the youth applauded you for that devotion, but that just doesn't happen. I think God's got something special in your life. And so God began using other voices around me to affirm this call. And so then as I went to Georgia Tech and met Andrea and got plugged into ministry there. And by the end of my time at Tech, I was beginning to think, you know what, I think it fits me to be involved in full-time ministry, but I don't know what that looks like. You know, would that be a youth group? Would that be college group? Would that, really didn't think pastor, I don't think at the time. But I didn't really know, but I didn't know when to start or where to start. So trying to get a job as an engineer first, that really didn't work out so well. God closed that door. And I had a chance to take one seminary class, which is going to be similar to the little study we're doing over the next 8 weeks on Wednesday nights. And so with that first seminary class, it was called Perspectives on the World Christian Movement, I was like, man, this is awesome. I could like do this all the time. And so I said, well, I guess maybe I should. So I went to Asbury Theological Seminary, which happened to be right down the road because we were living in Kentucky at the time. And so God just kept leading me step by step, kept calling me moment by moment. And the last parts of my call, one evening I was doing some ministry work, and I'd gone to Sunday evening church at a church plant we were connected with at the time. And a lay pastor, this guy, probably had a high school education. He's a lay pastor. He got to preach some on Sunday night for this little church plant. And, probably me and half a dozen people were there. So, it's not the place where I would expect to hear a call. And his preaching would not necessarily be the preaching where I would expect to hear a call. I mean, as I said, just nice guy, good heart, but, not the most brilliant. But he read the scripture, I don't even remember what he preached, but he said this, no greater love than this is to lay down one's life for one's friends. And Jesus says, you're my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father I've made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. And so this is my command, to love each other. And I said, I don't remember anything he said that night, but I do remember that the moment where he began to talk about, you did not choose me, I chose you. It's like Jesus was right there, and he was speaking to my heart. Chris, you didn't choose to go down this path. I have chosen you to go down this path. And all my life has never been the same since then. There's been other little steps in the call. There's another verse in Isaiah where Isaiah shares that the Lord had said, help the people remember that my name is exalted. Help the people remember that my name is exalted. But this is my call. And so this is why I do what I do. And why we're worshiping together today. And why I have the privilege I've had of leading on the last 7 years. Because Jesus called me like he called Peter and Andrew and James and John. And though I'm not worthy to anywhere near fill their shoes, it's been a privilege. And so, has Jesus called you? Have you heard his voice? Has he invited you on a journey? If so, you'll never be the same. You see, because if you're feeling lost and not sure what direction your life is headed, Jesus, in his call, gives you a path. Right? Come, follow me. Come, follow me. The path is a person. It's Jesus himself. And he's the one that we begin to follow and journey with wherever it takes us. And as the scripture shares, that new adventure does require us to change how we're doing life in the present. You see, when Jesus calls, let me make sure I get it right. I'll check my notes. When Jesus calls, every call is a full life call. When Jesus calls, every call is a full life call. That it means when Jesus calls who you are, your response is to be, if it's yes, it's a yes of surrender. Surrender everything. Right? But not every call is necessarily a full-time call. Now, for Peter, James, Andrew, and John, it was a full-time call. It was a call to leave everything and follow Jesus. But I don't think every call is that kind of call. You know, I think very likely Jesus also talked to James and John's father. He may also have spent time with the servants who were in the boat, but they ended up staying and doing their job in the boat because that was not part of their call. And so when God calls us, he calls us to surrender and to say, Lord, where do you want to send me? I'll go. But when he calls us, sometimes it's a full-time call to leave everything. Other times it's a call to make space and make room so that you can put Jesus first and follow him as he continues to say, keep doing what you're doing. And so with that, when we're lost, he gives us a direction. Follow me. Imitate my life. Let me mentor you and shape you and bless you. But also, when we feel purposeless and we don't know the meaning of life, he gives us a mission. He gives us a mission. Come, follow me, and I will make you fish for people. I'll teach you how to catch folks, men and women, children and teens. I'll teach you how to get out of the boat. I'll teach you how to call people by name by the seaside and invite them on a faith journey too. And as Jesus calls us, he equips us. And my heart and prayer for Jackson United Methodist Church in the weeks and days ahead is that we cannot just talk about fishing for people. We cannot just do Bible studies on witnessing or fishing for people, or not just do Sunday school classes, or not just do sermons on it, but actually we can hear God's call in a way that says, you know what, I want to be equipped, but after I'm equipped, I want to get out there and I want to go fishing. I want to be a part of God's mission in the world. And I want to see what God may do and through that. And I'm willing to give my life, my time, and my energy to do that. And as we do, the church leaves the building and sees what God may do. And so I want to kind of share this, what this looks like. First, I want to share a call story of a missionary who said yes, named Robert Morrison. And this just kind of reflects that sometimes our call to follow Jesus have a cost. And sometimes our calls to follow Jesus don't seem very fruitful. But yet we give everything and follow him anyway. This comes from Dennis Kinlaw's devotional book. And he just has some awesome stories in here. I've been trying to figure out when to share this story, so we're going to do it today. Robert Morrison had been a young British man studying accounting when God saved him and called him to the mission field. And when he arrived in China, the Chinese learned that what his mission was. They booted him out. In those days, people who went to the mission field, they went for life. There was no such thing as going on furlough. So Robert went to Macau, which is a Portuguese colony off the Chinese coast. He stayed there a little while and then returned to China. But again, he was deported. So he found a job with the East India Company as an accountant. Periodically, he would travel into China, only to be expelled each time. Morrison worked all day for the East India Company, which hated missionaries, but at night, he translated the Bible into Chinese. Eventually, he finished translating the Bible, and later, he died in Macau. For days after his death, there was no agreement where to bury his body. The Chinese certainly did not want a Christian to be buried in their cemetery, and the Roman Catholics were not about to have a Protestant buried in their cemetery. Finally, someone negotiated with the Roman Catholic Church Archbishop, who sold one cemetery plot so they could bury Robert Morrison. He was rejected all his life. He was rejected even in death. Rarely do we recognize the cost that other people have paid to be faithful to the call of the Lord Jesus. In our society, we focus so much on our own personal needs that few people will stand up and say, whatever God asks, I will do. Are you willing to do that? Brothers and sisters, here's the life of Robert Morrison. He was called to the mission field, he went to the mission field, and by the end of his life, he probably thought, I haven't done a lick of what I was sent here to do. But yet he was obedient to the call. The good news is that's not the end of the story. You see, Dennis Kinlaw was in China in 1982 and put these two pieces together. He had went to a Bible study taking place, and he looked around, and he said he received the shock of his life. 60% of the audience of like 300 people was under 30 years of age, which meant that all but the smallest of those had been born under Mao. And under Mao's regime, they were born under a government hostile to Christianity. The Christian parents must have hesitated to talk to their children about Christ, lest the police hear the children speak about him, and the whole family would be sent to prison. So after the service of this Bible study with 300 people, he had tea with the old pastor and said, "Sir, I have a question. Am I right that at least 60% of this audience was under 30 years of age?" He smiled and said, "Yes. Let me ask another question. If they're under 30 years of age, weren't they born under Mao?" "Yes." There were volumes of suffering in that one word. "How under the sun did they become believers?" He smiled as if he had a secret and didn't know whether he could trust me with it. Then he simply said, "They're children of believers, or else they're friends of children of believers, or else they're friends of children of believers." At that moment, all I could think about was a Chinese mom and dad who were willing to risk their lives so their children could know about Christ. They were willing to risk their lives so their children can know about Christ. Do we know? We talk about persecution of the church here in the United States. We have no clue what that means. We really don't. At night, they could close all their shutters, pull a stone out from the floor, take out an old Chinese Bible, and read it to their children. The salvation of those children came from reading the Bible that Robert Morrison gave his life to translate. No devotion to Christ is ever wasted. No lover of Christ is ultimately rejected. Everybody's redemption begins in somebody else. What is he calling you to do? And that's our question this morning. Have you heard the call of Jesus? If so, how has that call guided your life? May it go deeper so that you may find more that the Lord has for you. Whether big or small, nothing is wasted when we follow Jesus. Because there are opportunities before us to get out of doors, to share our faith, to make disciples. I close with this story of examples of how modern churches are beginning to find ways to take Jesus outside in the community once again. Growing up as a pastor's daughter, Katie in Florida learned early on that there were people all around her who would never find their way to church. She had her own kids. She began to recognize that many of her peers were busy and struggled to connect with God and their family and neighbors. So Katie met regularly with a stroller group of other young moms, and they would discuss real personal heart issues. They puzzled over the missing piece that they needed to ensure their children would grow up to be good people. They found themselves wishing the rest of their families could have such a space for vulnerable, authentic connection. Katie knew that they were longing for church, but not the kind she grew up in. So she invited them to her house for a brainstorming discussion, complete with giant sticky notes, where they discussed important questions like, how can we love our neighbors, and how do people connect with God? Their first meeting took place on an autumn Sunday morning, The group met together to connect with God and each other in the form of a short devotional and a long bike ride. Today they gather under the umbrella of name of Missing Peace. Their mission is finding God, each other, and self through service, physical activities, spiritual practices, and intellectual engagements in community. On Sunday at 10:30 a.m., they gather for activities that include prayer, meditation, labyrinth walks, wiffle ball, paddleboarding, flag football, and more. Through it all, they are discovering how to connect with God in their everyday lives and exploring how to better love their neighbors. Brothers and sisters, we've got to get out of the building a little better. And God is looking for those who would say, yes, I want to be part of that. And I hope you might consider how Jesus might call you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you today that you have not left us alone. Lord Jesus, we thank you that as you call Peter and James and John and Andrew, you keep on calling those you choose. You keep on calling those you love. You keep on calling, looking for us to be willing to say yes. Lord, help us say yes to opportunities in the days ahead. Opportunities to be out and about, connect with people, call their name, find ways to make disciples, and build your church in this community and around the world for your glory. So Lord, help church lead the building and help us follow you, now and always, for your glory, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Oh,
Lord Jesus. May you hear his voice and speak to your heart. May it guide your path in little ways and big ways. And may the power of the Holy Spirit fill you and encourage you to dream new dreams, to have great courage, and to be a part of what God wants to do before us. For his glory now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Have a good day.
Gracias.